Hello and welcome again to Expounding the Bible. I am your host, Nathanael Morel, and today we have our guest again, Rafael Altamar. Now, some of you may remember Brother Altamar. Rafael, he was with us when we did our study on why do youth rebel against God and parents, and that was really successful, really enlightening study. If you haven't seen it, you can go back and you'll find it. It's there. And but today we want to talk about I was asked by one of our subscribers to deal with a subject on how do we study the Bible effectively. And that is what we are going to do today. We want to look at basic details but hard evidence on how do we study the Bible very successfully. So Ralph, I want to ask, have you experienced, before we get to our first scripture, have you experienced anybody who's ever like doubted the Bible into how, you know, it like deals with or like having trouble with people studying the Bible effectively so then they can understand it successfully?
Yes, there's a lot of people that when they go through the Bible, they say, you know, they really, sometimes they don't know how to go through the Bible, or they'll be like, the Bible's, you know, it's hard to understand, or I don't know how you jump from one place to another, and like, and how do you figure it out, you know? And it says, how can you go through so many things to figure out one thing? But you know, in this study, we're going to see how the proper way is to study the Bible, what the Bible teaches about itself, and how we must study itself, because the Bible gives us a good outline of how it should be studied, and in what way, in what manner of mind, and in what way you should approach the Bible.
All right, that's very good. So now let's go to our first example on how do we study. We're going to take this step at a time, because we don't want to skip any steps. We want to really analyze a little bit without taking a lot of time also. So let's go to our first step. Let's go to Daniel chapter 9. The first thing we do when we open the Bible in a sermon, or in a Bible study, whatever, we have to come and pray. Mm-hmm. We got to pray for God's guidance to come as we are going to do this. Because if you don't invite the Holy Spirit, then you ain't going to have no light shining on to you. So the first thing we do is we pray. And we see this example in Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9. And we want to read verse 3. And then we go down to verse 22. And the thing is that here's Daniel. Daniel has been given a vision from God. Mm-hmm. He can't understand it too well. So in order for him to understand, he goes to the Bible, to the scriptures, to see if he can find some sort of explanation. Mm-hmm. And he says that he went to go study it out, and he went and did something. It says here in verse 3, "And I, Daniel, and I set my face unto the Lord to seek by prayer and supplications with fasting and sackcloth and ashes." So he went by prayer. One of the things he did before he went to study his Bible, he went and he prayed God and asked God for guidance and understanding. Mm-hmm. And we see in verse 22, God sent an angel, and the angel told Daniel. It says, "And he, the angel, informed me, Daniel, and talked with me, and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding. At the beginning of thy supplications, and the commandment came forth, and I will show thee that thou art greatly beloved." So he came, and it also says, if you read on verse 23, I'm sorry, it says, "Beloved, therefore understand the matter and consider the vision." So the angel, after Daniel prayed, the angel came down, God sent the angel, and God heard Daniel's prayer and said, "Angel," mm-hmm. it was the angel Gabriel, "go down and give Daniel the skill and understanding and the wisdom." So that just goes to show the power of prayer. When you come God with a humble heart, humble attitude, and you go and you open his word, and you pray for God's guidance, God will send you his angels and his Holy Spirit to be with you and enlighten you. Another example also, another step when you go to the Bible and go to study the Bible, whether it's in a sermon, Bible study, or in your daily study. I want to read from Ellen White, Gospel Workers, 1892 edition. Mm-hmm. This is chapter 18, Gospel Workers, 1892, page 125, where it says, the chapter is, How Shall We Search the Scriptures? And it says, How shall we search the Scriptures in order to understand what they teach? We should come to the investigation of God's Word with a contrite heart, a teachable and prayerful spirit. We are not to think as did the Jews, that our own ideas and opinions are infallible. Nor we are not to think like the papist, that certain individuals are the sole guardians of the truth and knowledge, that men have no right to search the Scriptures for themselves, but must accept the explanation given by the fathers of the church. We should not study the Bible for the purpose of sustaining our preconceived opinions, but with the single object of learning what God has said. So that's a good, basically solid mm-hmm. foundation on how, what type of attitude should we come when we open up the Bible, because the Bible is God's word. So let's see what God has to teach us, not we to teach God.
Yeah, and I think it's important, because just looking at Daniel 9, if you read verse 4 right after it, he says, And I prayed unto the Lord my God, and made my confession, and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy to them that love him, and to them that keep his commandments. So God, here Daniel is making his desire known. He's coming unto God, praying to God for understanding and wisdom, and he's making God known. He makes his, you know, he makes what he wants known. He's telling God, listen, I need you here. I need your understanding. This is what my problem is. This is what I want to understand. And then he goes on, and he goes through his prayer. And that's why he says, I heard your prayer. I heard your specific desire. Mm-hmm. And I have come to give you that specific answer to what you have asked for.
And he comes with a humble attitude, with a prayerful spirit, not coming like God, tell me what I should do so then I can set this guy straight, you know. Mm-hmm. is teach me so then I can teach others. So that's the first thing we want to notice, is though that first is important step.
Yes.
And once you get into that step, then we can start dealing with how the Bible is supposed to be the voice of God and how we're supposed to understand it.
Mm-hmm. And I think when we think about the voice of God, a perfect text has to be John 16. If we can just go to John 16. In John 16, reading verses 13 and 14.
John 16?
Mm-hmm. 13 and 14. And let us read it first. It says, Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. And we see here, it says, we see when we're looking at it, it says the Spirit of truth. The Spirit of truth is going to bring you all knowledge, and it's going to guide you into all truth. So if you're trying to study the Bible, you need to ask for this Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one that's going to enlighten you, is going to open these pages. And after you've prayed, you just accept the Holy Spirit, and by its leading, it's going to teach you all the truth that the Bible has.
By prayer.
Yes.
That's how the way the Holy Spirit is going to come and lead you into all truth. And it's very interesting, because we're going to go back and forth, and every time it's going to reflect this verse right here. Mm-hmm. That the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. And before I get too carried away, we want to before I get into step number 5, we have mm-hmm. to first deal with step number 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Mm-hmm.
So this is step number 2 here. Step number 1, we pray. Mm-hmm. Step number 2, we accept that once we pray,
the Holy Spirit
mm-hmm. will come down unto us. And then when once you get ready to study the Bible, you got to keep in mind that the Bible was given by God. You have, because if it's not given by God, why are you studying it so intensively for? You know, how, if you're not going to study the Bible effectively, you have to first admit it's from God, mm-hmm. or else why you're even on it, you know? Mm-hmm. So let's go to Second Timothy 3 verse 16, and we're going to look at a couple of verses here.
And while we're going there, we see it says that the Holy Spirit will not speak of itself, but will only speak of the truth. And that's important when you later on one of the later steps, because we see that it's only giving truth. It's not speaking of itself. It's not giving of itself. It's not like talking itself up. So when we know truth, we'll know that truth is always pointing back to Christ, putting the aim back on God and not putting the aim on self.
Right. So this is 2 Timothy 3 and verse 16. So when you study the Bible, you got to realize, you got to accept this right here. It says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, which we're going to be dealing with later on, because a lot of people get false doctrine, which mm-hmm. is where they err on that truth part, and a lot of people get good doctrine. So it says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction of doctrine, and for instruction in righteousness. So you first have to sit down and say, before I pray for God to help me study this Bible, and then you have to, the second step is you got to accept that the Bible is inspired by God.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to accept that the Bible is the voice of God to guide you into all truth. And we're going to see that. You have to accept that the Bible teaches, not only is the Bible the word or the voice of God,
mm-hmm.
but the Bible is God.
Mm-hmm.
And we see that in John chapter 1. We're going to look at a couple of verses here, and we're going to show this. John chapter 1, and we're going to read verse 1. Now, it's similar to Genesis 1 verse 1, but it's a little bit different. It puts things in a little different light. John 1 verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So the Word of God, the Bible, not just mm-hmm. is it God's voice talking to you, but it is God himself. Because
mm-hmm.
here it says that the Word and God are one. The Word was in God and the Word was God. So once we accept that the Bible is God and God trying to talk to us, then we can go to Thessalonians 2:13 just to establish the point a little more. Thessalonians 2, and then we're going to go to 1 Peter. Thessalonians 1 Thessalonians 2:13, and this is Paul talking, and he says, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God which effectually worketh also in you that believe. So this again goes to our mm-hmm. study. If you believe that the Bible is God, and the Bible is specifically God's word, and it says, he says, I thank thee, because when Paul preached the mm-hmm. gospel to these people from the word of God, as we will read also in 1 Peter, Paul preached to these people the word of God, and he is saying, I thank you all that you guys didn't receive it as my words
mm-hmm.
or anybody else's words. You received it as God's words. And he says, by doing that, and you believe in it, because you pray that the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth, and you believe in it, it says that now is going to work effectually or effectively mm-hmm. in your life if you believe it.
And we see that it says it works effectually in your life. You see that it's doing a work in your life when you accept it. And we don't have to go there, but when you read in 2 Timothy, mm-hmm. right after it says, you know, the word of God is given for instruction, reproof, correction, and, you know, being growing in righteousness.
Right.
It says all that is given so that the man of God should be thoroughly furnished and perfect unto all good works.
Right.
So it has a purpose. The word of God taken in its correct in its correct context and studied with a humble nature. And as we go through these things, it has a purpose so that we could grow up to the whole stature that God has set. God has set a standard, and this is the way where we have to reach that standard.
And that's where that scripture goes, this is the way, walk ye in it, which is, it looks like a bumpy road, but is actually the perfect road, the road of light shining. That's why David says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, because it is the perfect path. If you believe it, it will work effectively. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1. So Paul here, he says, I thank you that when I preached the word to you, when Paul preached the word to them, they didn't take it as the words of Paul. They took it as the word of God, which is something we have to realize when we are studying the Bible. We have to realize that this is God talking to me, talking to you, talking to I, talking to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't have that in mind, then we're missing the concept of studying the whole Bible. 1 Peter 1 and verse 25, it says, but the word of the Lord endureth forever, and this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. So if you got anybody preaching the quote-unquote gospel, doesn't use the Bible, and if he does, is reading a wrong term of the Bible, guess what? It's a false gospel.
Yep.
So that is just to show, when we go with an attitude, we pray, we go with an attitude that all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and then we accept that it's inspired, and then we have to accept that it is God talking to us, because the Bible is God's word, is a precept.
And laying on that point where you say that if someone is preaching the gospel, someone's giving the word of God, they must be able to be in harmony with the word of God. You can't go up preaching the word of God and not having the actual word of God with you, and you have to go on these precepts. And that's why we want to go to Isaiah 28, because the Bible has a specific way that it needs to be studied. Isaiah 28, because we know that the Bible builds on itself, and the Bible will never contradict itself, and the prophets that wrote of Old Testament and New Testament, they all coincide, and none of them can gainsay or contradict each other, unless the Bible would be wrong, and we know that's not true. So they all have to be in harmony. So when precepts and the gospel is given, it has to be in harmony with the word of God.
It goes like the prophets are subject to the prophets.
Yes. Let's see here in Isaiah 28. Isaiah 28, verses 9 and 10. And he says, whom shall he teach knowledge? And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little. And the word of God makes it so important that it repeats it again. You see, verse 13, it says, but the word of the Lord was unto them precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little, that they might go and fall backward and be broken, snared and taken. So he repeats it. This is how it must be done, line upon line, line upon line, building, building, precept. You got to take one precept and just keep on building it and compare the word of God with itself.
And you might be asking, if the Bible is God and Jesus is also God, did Jesus follow this example? Because obviously Jesus has to follow the example set forth by his own word. So let's go to Luke chapter 24. This is a perfect, that was a perfect building block, Isaiah 28. You must have precept upon precept and line upon line. And the perfect example, you might say, what is that? Precept on precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. And really what it means is comparing verse with verse, chapter with chapter, thought by thought. You know, you search the Bible here and you search the Bible there and see what conclusion does it come with, and see if the Bible makes sense, which obviously it has to make sense when you do it right. Luke 24, did Jesus follow that example that Raphael just pointed out? Precept upon precept, line upon line. And we want to read let me see, verse 24. Let's go with let's go with 26. And the context of this, the story, that's another thing. You got to read the Bible in its proper context, but we'll come to that in a moment. The story of this is when Christ died, he resurrects, he appears himself to two of his friends, mm-hmm. and they don't know that it's Christ. They don't know that yet, but it's him. And he knows them, but they don't recognize him. And he's walking with them, and they think he's a stranger. And they're all depressed, you know, because their best friend Jesus died. And he's over here walking with them, and he says, well, what's going on? They don't know it's him. So they go, oh, you know, Jesus got crucified, this wonderful man. And Jesus starts telling them, but the Bible has prophesied these things. The Old Testament, which was the Bible for the Jews, prophesied all these things that just happened. And he started opening up and having Bible study with them as they were walking back home. And they started thinking, wait a minute, this stranger knows more about the scriptures than we do. Because he was tying it up. Christ was the best teacher on this earth. Uh-huh. And he was tying the Bible up very perfectly. And it says here, in verse 26, this is Christ speaking to them. He's saying, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and enter into his glory? It says in verse 27, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he, or Christ, expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. You see, that's sort of a little where we get the word expounding the Bible from, just to make that, because Jesus, he says here, he expounded onto them, or he dissected. He started studying. He started research. He started going here a little and there a little, and precept upon precept. And you know it because it says beginning at Moses. He went to the Old Testament, started at Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, and it says all the prophets. So he was going book by book. He probably went to Isaiah 53, where it talks about Christ. He probably went to Malachi. Micah. I believe it's Micah 5 or Micah 6, where it talks about where the Messiah will be born. He probably went to places in Jeremiah, where it predicted that Christ, Emmanuel, and Christ was going to be born from a virgin. He probably also went to different places in Isaiah, as I mentioned, Isaiah 53. Mm-hmm. And of course, the Psalms. Psalms mentions a lot of things concerning the Messiah going to be put to death. And I'm sure he went to Daniel. Daniel chapter 9. So he went to all these places and started doing Bible study with them. Again, he is expounding the Bible. He's going precept upon precept, line upon line, putting things in its proper order. And then they went and invited him to go eat. And then that when he broke bread, that's when their eyes were open and they saw that, yes, it was Christ. And that's when they believed, because they were convicted. And they, no one taught the Bible better than Christ, because Christ is the Bible. So whenever you put things in its proper order, like Christ did, like those two guys, your eyes will be open. The Holy Spirit comes by prayer, and it will give you skill and understanding like Daniel, and that's when the Bible becomes a marvelous light to you.
And it's impressive because if you look at just, Christ gives him like a subtle reproof in verse 25, right before he breaks, you know, breaks these scriptures up and tells him, he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. So he's not just taking them back to what he said when he was alive, but he tells them, O fools and slow of heart, you have not understood all that has been building, you know, through, that's why you have to take him back to Moses, right, and bring him all the way back, because he's like, you have not, you know, believed all the things, all that the prophets have spoken, even from the beginning. And I think this is a good place to go to John 5. If you go to John 5, because he tells them, oh fools and slow of heart to believe all that the, you know, prophets have written. And he tells them when he, you know, when he was on the earth, he says in John 5, if I can get there, John 5.
And notice, before you make that point, notice how he went and used the Old Testament. I mean, today, nowadays, you got people that only stay with the New Testament. You cannot study the Bible using half a Bible.
Yeah.
You have to use all or none, because that's the only way God's going to speak to you. Even though most of the laws that are in the Old Testament were nailed to the cross, and that's a different subject. I don't want to go too deep into that. But they still exist through example spiritually through the laws in the New Testament.
Mm-hmm.
And even though when you study the New Testament, you see that it's almost similar to the laws of the old, it's just that they're in a different way. They're a little more different. So so you have to study the old, because the Old Testament and all the laws that were in the Old Testament points to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
The New Testament, all the laws in the New Testament points to Christ in his heavenly work. And that's the importance, because if you try to understand part two, New Testament, without understanding part one, which is the old, mm-hmm. you ain't gonna understand nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta understand all the parts in its proper order.
Because you see that in the Old Testament, everything is given, all the prophecies, everything is given. And part two, or the New Testament, is like the coming, the fulfillment of all that is in the old. So how can you know the fulfillment when you don't even know the beginning?
Right.
Nothing can, you know, these are just the fulfillment of all that's been prophesied in the old. And after the fulfillment, it's building up after that. But if we read here in John 5, building on this point, John 5, when we just start at, we're just going to read verse 39. And it says, "Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me." And verse 46 says, "For ye had believed Moses, ye would have believed me, for he wrote of me." So he's referencing again Moses and all the things in the Old Testament, because he says they testified of him.
It says also in verse 47, "But if ye believe not his writings," or Moses' writings, "how shall ye believe my words?" So if you don't believe the Old Testament, mm-hmm. how in the world do you intend to believe the New Testament? I mean, they're tied together.
Mm-hmm.
You can't avoid them. You cannot have a Bible study strictly on the New Testament. You can prove a lot of things, but it will be incomplete. Because the Bible, there's a reason why there are 66 books in the Bible, mm-hmm. old and new. If it wasn't important, God would have only said, read one portion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so people who just want to stay on one testament, you know, that's why they most of the stuff they believe is mostly error, because some of the answers to their questions are in the old, and they don't want to even look at the old.
Mm-hmm.
You can't study the Bible effectively, correctly, in that manner. And that'll also lead us, you want to take us to Acts 17, verse 11?
All right, Acts 17.
We read about this certain group of people here.
Acts 17, verse 11. Acts 17, verse 11, we read about a certain people and their faithfulness and how they studied. If we just see Acts 17, verse 11 and verse 12, it says, "These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women which were Greeks, and of men not a few." And these people were, in verse 10 it says, "And the brethren," speaking with Paul and Silas, it says, "And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews." So it shows that they came to the Bereans in Berea, and they studied and they showed with them. And then the Bereans were more noble than those others, because instead of taking things at face value, they went and they studied the scriptures for themselves. And I would like to put this Ellen White quote from Christian Education.
Mm-hmm.
In Christian Education, chapter 6, page 58, it says, "We should not take the testimony of any man as to what the scriptures teach, but should study the word of God ourselves. If we allow others to do our thinking, we shall have crippled energies and contracted abilities."
So to explain that,
mm-hmm.
and the Bereans is a very good example. You see, like, we're not supposed to take the word of anybody. All the preachers that preach to us, mm-hmm. even us, for example, don't just take our word for it. You're mm-hmm. supposed to go like these Bereans do, study the Bible for yourself to mm-hmm. see what the preacher says, to see if what we say, to see if what anybody else says, if it is meeting according to the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they did. They didn't just say, amen, the preacher said this, let's go do it. No, they went mm-hmm. back home, they said, we got to prove this. Not that we are doubting anything mm-hmm. that anybody says, but just to see if it's in line with the Bible.
Yeah,
if it is, good. Mm-hmm. If it's not, then bring it to the attention of somebody.
Mm-hmm. And it's not, yeah, as he was saying, it's not, you're not, it's not an insult. It's not saying that you're the person that's speaking is not inspired or is not speaking the words of truth, but it's you going back and you making sure that this, that you know it for yourself. The man up there or whoever's presenting the script, the subject is presenting it, but you have to study it for yourself and see, you know, if it is truth or not. Not saying that they don't know what they're talking about, but you have to see for yourself, because it says here that if you do not see it for yourself and you're just taking everything at face value, your understanding is crippled, because you're not relying on anything. You're not relying on God to give you wisdom. You're just taking somebody else's wisdom and attributing it to yourself.
Right. Let's go to a good explanation for that right there. It is 2 Timothy. Let's go back to 2 Timothy.
Mm, 2 Timothy.
We read 2 Timothy 3:16, but I want to go to 2 Timothy 2:15. Mm-hmm. 2 Timothy 2:15, and this is a very good piece of scripture here. It says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth." When you read that dividing is not divide the Bible in two and cause division, mm-hmm. and disunity among everybody. When you read that word dividing, and I wrote it down here, when you look at it in the original Hebrew and Greek, to divide means to teach the truth directly and correctly. To dissect or expound. And we just saw that Jesus expounded the Bible. He expounded the scriptures. So when it says here, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the words of truth, it means to teach the truth correctly. To dissect the scriptures. Look precept upon precept. Mm-hmm. That's why it says study to show thyself approved. Don't just take, but study it out.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how we get into false doctrine. Because mm-hmm. people take the Bible, do not study it in its proper context, its proper form, and they do not take the necessary steps. And they just want to go to the Bible for their own purpose,
mm-hmm.
to prove others wrong or to try to start something new. And they read, sometimes they read only one verse and that is it.
Mm-hmm.
They base their whole teaching on just that one verse,
mm-hmm.
failing to realize that when you read the next verse, it quickly cancels off their original teaching of one verse, because one verse usually explains the other,
mm-hmm.
or another book explains the other book. So they fail to realize sometimes people just read half a verse,
mm-hmm.
half a verse, make a teaching on that half a verse, and then failing to realize that the next half of the sentence actually explains the first half.
Either that or they have not looked at the context of it. Because some people have it and they take a verse or they take half of a verse. Or they just take a section of the Bible and take it out of context. Or put a wrong interpretation on it. And if they would take the time to read and to understand the context, they would know that this is not the meaning of this text.
Right.
This is not where this is supposed to go.
If you look at all false all doctrines, actually, all doctrines, whether they're true or false, come from the Bible. All of them.
Mm-hmm.
And you may be asking, well, how is that so? Well, all doctrines, all theories, all of those theological things come from the Bible, whether they're true or false. The problem is, the true ones are the ones that are studied out effectively by prayer, realizing that the Bible is the voice of God and that the Bible is inspired, and putting things in its proper order, mm-hmm. again, precept upon precept, line upon line,
mm-hmm.
and studying like the Bereans, and rightly dividing the words of truth, seeing and teaching the truth correctly and dissecting the Bible. See what this verse compared to this scripture with that scripture, and this verse with that verse, and this line of thought with the other line of thought, And usually you come to a conclusion, a very clear conclusion, that mm-hmm. either this is true or that's false. So we're going to deal with them. How do we know a false doctrine?
And the Bible tells us exactly how to figure out if a doctrine is false or if it's true. And we go to Isaiah 8 for that.
Okay.
Isaiah 8, verse 16. Because the Bible gives us a very clear understanding of what's truth and what's not truth. And if it's not truth, what we're supposed to do. So let's go to Isaiah 8. Isaiah 8. And we're going to verse 16 and then reading 19 and 20. All right. It says, bind up the testimony, seal the law among thy disciples. And verse 20 says, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
So again, the word is God, and the mm-hmm. word was God. So they, if they don't speak according to the line of the Bible word,
mm-hmm.
then there is no light in them.
Mm-hmm. If they don't speak according to the law of God, to the word of God, and to the testimony of Jesus, the Bible says that they have no light in them.
They have no light in them. That's how you prove a false prophet. We also know, let's go to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, and then we're going to go to 2 Peter, and then we're going to go to 1 John. Ephesians chapter 4. As we begin to wrap this up a little bit. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 14. Let's read verse 13. It says, till we come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Verse 14, that henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. So he says, be no more children tossed to and fro, or study the Bible to show that self-approved. Get yourself a firm foundation, mm-hmm. so then you will not be carried away by any wind of doctrine. And again, there's good doctrine, there's bad doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
But it says a bad doctrine, you will know by the sleight of men and by the cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. What is this cunning craftiness? This craftiness of only taking one verse or half a verse,
mm-hmm.
and drawing up conclusions that sometimes you just say, how is that? And sometimes they'll be so crafty as to look like if they are dissecting the Bible correctly and expounding upon it, and they go back and forth trying to prove their point. But you just know they don't put things in the proper context. If they would just go a few verses more, it would see the context as to their preaching, and it will prove their doctrine false. Mm-hmm. But they don't go that far. Let's go to 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. Let's see here. Let's go to 15. I'm trying to find this specific thing. Okay, yeah. Let's just start at verse 15 and let's see where it'll take us. I want to go all the way to verse 18, but I'm not sure. But let's go to verse 15 first. It says, and account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, has written unto you. As also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also in other scriptures, unto their own destruction. Therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things, beware lest ye fall, being led away with error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. But verse 18 says, but grow in grace in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to him be glory both now and forever. Amen. So let's analyze this. Peter is saying, Paul writes epistles, and we know that because we see Paul's writings in the majority of the New Testament.
Mm-hmm.
So Peter is saying, in Paul's writings, they are those people which have a hard time trying to understand,
mm-hmm.
and also work in craftiness, as we read in Ephesians.
Mm-hmm.
And it says that they are, it says, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they also do other scriptures. It says they are unstable and they rest. Not just the scriptures that Paul brings out, but other scriptures as well. So what is that word rest? W-R-E-S-T. It's mm-hmm. different than the regular rest. It actually mm-hmm. begins with a W. That word rest. And I looked up that word rest in the original Hebrew and Greek. And it says, actually in the original Greek. And it says, to twist or pervert the Bible. So these guys will take the teachings, the true and good doctrines of Paul. Paul only spoke good doctrines. And they would take it, they would rest it, or they would twist it, being crafty, as we read in mm-hmm. Ephesians. Being crafty, they would rest the scriptures, or pervert, or twist, and make it seem like if it's something else when it's actually not. And that's actually what they do, what false teachers do to all the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
They take one piece of line, and they may take another piece of line over here, both taken out of its original context, and they would twist it and make it seem as if it's something, but it's not. And we read in 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. People rest the scriptures. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1. And it says, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. And that's a warning. Believe ye not every spirit. Believe not every person, mm-hmm. but try the person out. Study the Bible effectively in its proper form and mm-hmm. see whether these guys are teaching truth or error.
And to add on to that, I know we're getting close to closing, but to add on to that, I just want to go back to 2 Peter 2, mm-hmm. and starting at the beginning at verse 1 and 2, it says,
goodness.
But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of.
Wow.
So it shows here that there will be false teachers in this day, and not just people. I mean, there will people have false doctrines, but there will be false teachers and people purposefully rest the teachings of God and pervert them. And it says they may be even among you, and these will speak evilly of the truth and will turn the truth into a damnable heresy unto God. So that's why the Bible gives us the caution to say, study the spirits, try them out. If someone says something, study it like the Bereans,
right.
So that you would not be deceived.
Right. And also a very key ingredient to this, when we study the Bible as a group, or even by ourselves, sometimes there comes a time when people have different types of Bibles.
Mm-hmm.
And one person's Bible says one thing, and another person's Bible says another.
Mm-hmm.
And then and another person's Bible, they're not maybe even the scripture there at all. So then you start saying, wait a minute, but that's not in my Bible. Or where mm-hmm. are you reading from? And you'd be like, we're reading in such and such. And they're like, well, that's not what it says here. So we got to find out what is the proper Bible. And really, you got to find the Bible that is closest as possible to the original Hebrew and Greek translations. Because mm-hmm. there are many versions of Bible out there, all for the purpose of resting the scriptures. Mm-hmm. Because I've seen people read different versions of Bible, and they come out of there with some wild doctrine ideas that are mm-hmm. truly false. But how do they come up with that? Because they're reading a Bible that supports these false ideas. And when you look at that Bible, it says that they take the explanations out of the original Hebrew Greek, but they sort of not revise it, but they put it in a way where it's the modern English. Mm-hmm. And they basically add their own interpretation instead of what the original Greek or Hebrew language, mm-hmm. which was the original words that Christ spoke. And instead of taking those words and translating them straight into English, they take those words, translate into English, and then the meaning in English, they'll add their own interpretation. Mm-hmm. For example, if in the old ancient text it says tomb. Mm-hmm. Let's just make that example. It says tomb. I will translate that in English, and I'll just write tomb. Mm-hmm. But instead of doing that, I'll just say, you know what? I don't like tomb. So I'll just put graveyard. Now you just twisted a different thing. Because instead of saying, we buried him in the tomb, as the original text said, mm-hmm. now it'll say, and we buried him in the graveyard. Mm-hmm. That's two different things. One is a tomb, the other one's a graveyard or cemetery, if you want to say. Mm-hmm. So that's two, and I'm just giving a light example. There are big time examples. When you compare the NIV, let's just say that, the NIV, and the closest, actually, when you look up in Google or you make your own study, the closest Bible to the original Hebrew and Greek languages, for the English people, it's the King James Version. For Germany, it might be the Lutheran Bible. In Spanish, it might be what we call the Reina Valera, which is almost like the King James Version Bible. But different languages vary at different types of Bibles. But mm-hmm. let's just stick with English language for now. For the English language, the King James Bible is the only Bible that says translated word for word from original Hebrew and Greek, thoroughly revised and put into English. Is mm-hmm. the only one that will take the actual word in Hebrew, the actual word in Greek, and translate it straight into English and write it how the way it says. Mm-hmm. All other Bibles will take that word, see what it is in English, and then, you know what, let's add my interpretation of it. Or take the word in Hebrew, see it in English, and just throw it away. They might not even put it in the Bible. That's what I believe Revelation says, do not add and do not take mm-hmm. away.
Yes.
So, you want to read that?
Yeah, I have it right here. And it says, "For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book." And that was Revelation 22, verses 18 and 19.
Yeah. So it says, do not add and not take away. Mm-hmm. When you look at how many versions of the Bible are out there are so many, all of which do not even say the same thing. And they'll all tell you, there is none Bible other than the King James Version that says translated word for word. Only the King James Version has that. Mm-hmm. Whatever it says in the Greek, this is what it's going to say in English. Not my interpretation, not others' interpretation. Mm-hmm. When you compare, I challenge you, do your study. Go to Google or go to the internet and write the difference. Let's just say the difference between the King James Version Bible and the NIV. I don't want to get too far into this because that'll be a different subject. But as I recall, there are about 64,000 words that are eliminated from the NIV mm-hmm. that are in the King James Version Bible. And these are words that verses, even whole chapters sometimes, are gone. Whole verses are missing. Multiple verses are missing or cut in half. And these mm-hmm. are very important doctrinal verses that we need to understand doctrine. It will not say that Christ is the Son of God. Let's make that example. Mm-hmm. The King James will. Mm-hmm. In the NIV, that verse may be completely chopped off. Mm-hmm. And there are multiple verses. I believe there's a few chapters that are just chopped off. So why would they do that? A few people say, oh, because they had a different earlier manuscript. That wasn't it. Satan says, I gotta rest the scriptures so different people can believe different points of doctrine and therefore stay away from the one and true translation. So as we are beginning to close, there was another quotation from Christian Education.
Yes, there was another on the same page, same Christian Education, chapter 6, and I believe it is the same page, just further down on it.
So we'll close with that.
Yes, it says, page 58 of Christian Education, chapter 6, but there is but little benefit derived from a hasty reading of the scripture. One may read the whole Bible through and yet fail to see its beauty or comprehend its deep and hidden meaning. One passage studied until its significance is clear to the mind and its relation to the plan of salvation is evident is more value than the perusal of many chapters with no definite purpose in view and no positive instruction gained.
So that is from Christian Education, page 58.
Mm-hmm.
And it again, it clearly says how the way we should study the Bible. So that is what we wanted to bring out to you today. I hope it was a great help to you. And that is what we wanted to deal with. I hope it was simple, easy to follow. These are words from the Bible. This is Expounding the Bible, where we dissect the truth. And again, don't take our word for it. Go to the Bible and see if these things are so. That is how we do our true study, according to what the Bible says. So that is what we have to bring you this time. Thank you for watching this video. If you like this video, please press like. Don't forget to subscribe. We are also on Facebook at Expounding the Bible. Until then, this is your host, Nathanael Morel, and our guest, Rafael Altamar, saying, have a blessed day.